Good morning. Turn to the person beside you right now and say, man, you look good. Oh, man, it's good to see you this morning. I'm so glad you're here. Today is actually the last day for Mac and Dean McCrary, and they're there in the back. I'm not going to say a whole lot because I do. I'll cry, and I'm not going to do that. Okay, maybe I will. They have served at this church so faithfully and have given, oh my gosh, they have been unpaid staff is what they've been. And if you want to look a picture of what servants look like, if you looked up in the dictionary, surely their pictures have to be there. They've made us better. And they're moving to Tennessee. They're out of God's will. I'm just kidding. I kind of got you, didn't it? You went, what? They're moving to Tennessee to be closer to family, and it's a move we know that they need to make and God's part of, but doesn't mean that we won't miss them any the less. And so I know today is, as you leave, if you'll just let them know that you love them and that you'll miss them. And I told Dee this morning, you know, we're just a phone call away, and anything that we can do to help them in Tennessee, that we'll be more than happy to do it in any way, shape, form, or fashion. Is that right? Amen. There we go. So we're finishing up this series today called Revolution or Resolution. And we've been thinking about this whole idea of really what it means to make New Year's resolutions. And we've been focusing on the fact that really New Year's resolutions really are just focused on us. And what we've tried to do in this series is to say, let's go a little bit further than that. Let's make it broader. Let's expand our thinking to make it more about making things better for the world. And you might be overwhelmed with that. So I can't make things better for the world. It's just little old bitty me and my talents and my gifts, and I'm not that gifted, and I don't have that much ability, and I don't have enough money, and all of the excuses that you would give. But I tell you what you can do. You can make the world a better place for your neighbor. Or maybe for the people that you live in, the people in your own home. What if husbands and wives started to look at each other and say, you know what can I do this year to make the world a better place for you and children? And what if they looked at their parents and said, you know what, mom, dad, I want to create a revolution in our home. And what can we do to make the world a better place, at least for you and in your slice of the world? So we've been talking about creating this revolution. And when I say revolution, I'm not talking about causing a revolt. I'm not talking about overthrowing the government, for the most part. I'm not talking about that at all. Actually, the word revolution comes from a Latin word that means this. It means to turn around, and that's what we've been talking about. We've been talking about, really, in case for those of you that are wondering how deep is the theology at Springwell, this is deep. This means going beyond the surface stuff. It means that for us as followers of Jesus is that we go deep into the Word so that we would begin to love like Jesus loves, and that we would begin to care like Jesus cares, and so that we would begin to look at other people and say, how can I create a revolution in your world? How can I turn things around for you? That's what that means, and that's pretty sweet. And I think the question that helps us kind of narrow down what slice of the world that we might want to put our focus on, it's a simple question. It's the question that we found in Nehemiah, and it's simply this: what is it that breaks your heart? What is it that breaks your heart? Now, a lot of things may disturb you, right? I mean, you may be watching the 6 o'clock news, and maybe there's a story, or maybe it's a commercial. It's something that you see on TV, and maybe you're disturbed by what you see, and maybe the thought for you is somebody should do something about that. Or maybe, you know, maybe it's a story that you hear. Maybe it's somebody you talked to at work, or somebody that you saw at school, or maybe you talked to a neighbor and you heard about the story of the plight of someone. You've heard about a crisis that happened, and as you hear that, you think, you know what, somebody should do something about that. But the truth of it is that nobody does. And really within a couple of days, maybe even a couple of hours, you've completely forgotten about the whole thing. But every once in a while, you know I'm telling the truth, every once in a while we hear about a story, or we see that thing on TV. And the thing of it is, for most of us, is we find ourselves thinking about it, waking up in the middle of the night. Every night that when we go to bed, the last thing on our mind is that story. It's that thing. And for the most part, we say, why in the world would I be thinking about this? I'm not gifted. I don't have the money. I don't have the ability to organize. I'm not a leader. And so we go through all of the reasons that we shouldn't be involved. But at the end of the day, you can't get past it. And you know why? It's because it's become a heart issue. It's because what doesn't make any sense, it's not logical when you look at your giftedness and when you look at your talents and when you look at your abilities and when you look at your economic situation. None of that makes sense. But suddenly what's happened is you've gone from something that's not just a sad story, but it's become a God thing in your life. And it's the only way that you can explain it. Nothing else really makes sense other than God has somehow burdened your heart. That's the way we like to talk about it in church terms, right? And so the problem with that really that arises when you start to look at what breaks your heart, really the problem that arises is that you have to decide, what am I going to do about it? And then there's another problem that arises, right? As you begin to think about what am I going to do about it, the next question that you think is, what's it going to cost me? And then you're going to deal with the question, okay, not only what is it going to cost me, but is it going to be worth it, right? And so we kind of snowball into all these different questions. And listen, if you've ever given your life away to a cause, not just a cause, but to a God call, then here's what you will know. It is absolutely worth it. But I think that by nature, we want to save a life, not lose a life, right? We spend a lot of money in making life better for us, easier for us. Most of us had a plan, and we started off, you know, when we were younger, and we thought, I just want to be able to push, to get that job, to make that money, to secure, to have that home, to have this. I want to make life better for me. I want to make life better for my family. Most of us, by nature, are life savers. And then you give your life to Jesus because you want life to be better and easier. I guess it depends on your weird theology, but as you begin to process that, and then suddenly you come to the words of Jesus, and Jesus says stuff like, whoever wants to save their life, you will lose it. What? And you're thinking, oh, time out, Jesus. Can we chat just for like a second? He would say, nope. Whoever wants to save their life, you will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me and the gospel will save it. And there we have this paradox. It really doesn't make sense. In order to be full, I have to be empty. What? Now, if you're like me, and I'm a big boy, and I love to eat, I mean, you don't even like that. The sound of that doesn't even sound good, does it? In order to be full, I have to be empty. And I'm thinking, no, in order to be full, I got to eat more. That's kind of my thought. And then Jesus says, you know what? If you want to save your life, you have to lose it. It's a paradox. It's a contradiction. It doesn't really seem to make sense. And then I think that we just have to figure out what losing our lives really looks like. What is that? I've grown up in church, and I've thought that maybe when I was young that what I heard, it was about devotion to God. If we'll just be devoted to God. Well, is losing your life devotion? Is it devotion or is it motion? Or is it devotion that causes and creates and pushes us to motion? I think that as Christians that we have made a tendency in our lives to substitute devotion for action. Just want to let you sit on that for a second. And if we're not careful, we'll become more comfortable with studying the Word than we actually will in doing what the Word says. And I was kind of raised in a very conservative church. I'm very conservative in my theology. In fact, I don't know if anybody you'll talk to theologically. I love the word. You know, I love the word. And I grew up in a time when there was a question to the legitimacy of Scripture. And I remember being a part of that denomination that we would beat our chest and we would say, "I believe in the inerrant, infallible Word of God." And we said it a lot like that. And if you don't say it like that, then you're really, you know, there's really no power to it. And I remember, I believe in the Father. And I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and we could just wax eloquent with our theology. I kind of grew up and that we were devoted to the Word, and we would say, I believe. But if we don't actually become doers of the Word, then here's my question. Really, what good is it to know the Word? And that's messing with some of you probably. But just hang on. Just don't check out yet. There's an interesting thing that will happen if you actually begin to read the Word. An interesting thing that will happen as you begin to read the Word. Watch this. Listen. As you begin to open up the Word, what you will find is that believing isn't enough. And don't you, right now, somebody wants to get up and say, that's not true. Well, I got some scripture for you. James 2, verse 17. So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Believing isn't enough. That's what he's saying. Believing isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it's dead and useless. Somebody may argue, some have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds or good works? I'll show you my faith. You want to talk about what you believe? I'm going to show you what I believe by my good works. This is James who's writing this. You say you have faith, for you believe that there's one God. Good for you. And I believe there's some sarcasm there. And maybe that's just because I can be sarcastic. I read that, you know. I think he was a little sarcastic. Well, good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. How foolish. Can't you see that faith without good deeds, without good works, is absolutely, positively useless? It's no good. All you are doing is beating the air with a lot of God talk. It's there. See, I told you, there's more to it than just believing the right stuff. You have to decide. When you decide to follow Jesus, is this just going to be some type of personal devotion? And if that's what you think, is it's just personal devotion, then personal devotion is not going to be enough. Listen, believing the right stuff is not enough. It's just not. And I think that some of us are more content to believe than we are to do. And some of you are thinking, well, that was James. And like, he was the brother of Jesus, and maybe he was like just ticked at Jesus when he wrote this, you know? Maybe the Holy Spirit was trying to guide him to say something else, and this slipped out anyway. Maybe this is what found on paper. So what did Jesus have to say? Well, I'm glad you asked. Matthew chapter 7, verse 26. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. See, it wasn't just James. These are the words of Jesus. This is what Jesus taught as well. But I think that as Christians, we are far more comfortable at times at standing on a soapbox and making theological points and arguments than we are. We're just more comfortable being against stuff. And it was interesting to me, especially in those early days for me when I was 19, 20 years old, trying to figure out the God thing, and I would begin to talk to other people. I mean, most people had this idea that the church, I don't really know what they're for, I just know what they're against. The church, we've been really, really good as a church at standing and telling the world what we're against. We just don't spend a lot of time actually saying what we're for. Now, some of you are thinking, well, don't we need to make stands? Of course we do. But sometimes we're way more content with making a point than we are in making a difference. But if all that we do is make points, then I don't think we'll ever make a difference. So today, I want to take you to one of the most familiar passages of Scripture in the Bible. And you don't even have to be a churchgoer to know this passage. And we just dealt with this a few weeks ago. It was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun with it then. And God just kind of brought me back to it again. It's this wonderful, beautiful passage that if you've ever been to a wedding, you've heard it, 1 Corinthians 13. It's the love chapter. It's written by a guy named the Apostle Paul. And if you don't know the Apostle Paul, you ought to get to know a little bit about him. because he had a huge, huge, huge impact on church history. In fact, you can't go to the New Testament. He's given credit for probably writing 13 books of the New Testament. So, like, when you're thinking about Jesus and heavyweight, you know, spiritual giants, Paul's definitely got to be at the top of the list. In fact, he was the bridge from Judaism to Gentiles. And most of us, you say, well, I don't even know what a Gentile is. It's a non-Jewish person, and that's like, you know, 99.9% of us that are here today, although we do have some wonderful Jewish folks that have been a part of this church. Just a few years after the death of Jesus, there are Jesus churches in Rome and Philippi and Ephesus and places like Corinth and Athens, Thessalonica, all these different port cities. And here's the reason why. It's because the Apostle Paul said it's not enough to just believe the right stuff. That's not enough. It's not enough just to believe the right stuff. And listen, it wasn't just believing the right stuff. It was what he found in that information. It wasn't just that Jesus is the Son of God and that he went to the cross and he died on the cross as the perfect Lamb of God for our sin. It was more than that for Paul. Paul, this was a personal thing for Paul. And Paul said, you know what? I am so excited about what I found. And that he was the Son of God, that he died on the cross, and that he was raised from the dead on the third day. He's alive, and he stepped into my life. And Paul was so jacked about Jesus that he wanted to tell everybody. He said, it's not enough to just know the right stuff. You got to go tell everybody. You got to share that. And so he got on a ship that most of us would have never got on. It was a cargo ship. It was not a Mediterranean cruise. And he visited all these port cities, and he planted all these churches. And then he wrote these letters back to them to encourage them. And sometimes it was to straighten them out, and mostly 1st and 2nd Corinthians. To be quite honest, he was straightening out a lot of things that they got wrong. And so 1st Corinthians is called 1st Corinthians because it was the first letter. The Bible's so hard, isn't it? And then 2 Corinthians is called 2 Corinthians because it was the, you guys are amazing. I know that 11 o'clock crowd won't get that, but I mean, you guys are the really smart crowd, I could tell. Yeah. Here's the thing, and here's what I want to challenge you with just a little bit. I don't know if I did this a few weeks ago, but here's the thought. Every wedding you go to, these are words that we read, you know, and they're so sweet. Love is, you know, and so the definition of love, and we're so pumped up, and so we read all. But listen, here's what I'm going to say this morning. These are very disturbing words. Very disturbing words. I don't think Paul's intention was ever to just write these sweet words and to define love. In fact, there is not a definition for love. There's only a description for what love should look like. I'm just saying. So in the previous chapter, chapter 12, Paul's been talking about giftedness. And you should just read sometimes. Just Google it for fun and see what Google brings up. But many theologians believe that this particular church was probably like the most spiritually gifted church in all the New Testament. Did you get that part? They were like the most spiritually gifted church in the New Testament. But they were terrible at loving each other. And in fact, listen, I've already told you, it's a topical letter. I mean, chapter 1, he deals with this. Chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, he's dealing with all these problems in the church. And the reason that they were having so many problems in the church was because they were really, really good at study. They were really, really smart. They were superly spiritually gifted. But they just could not get the love thing right. And so he goes back and he writes this little chapter. So in this little chapter, he addresses those who think that God is more impressed with devotion than he is motion. In this particular chapter, he's really speaking to those who think that spiritual gifts are more important than spiritual fruit. So what he's going to do in this particular chapter is he's going to address those of us that maybe think that God's mostly impressed with what we know as opposed to what we do. So let's jump in and see what he's got to say. And then those famous words that all Baptists love. If I speak in the tongues, and everybody got nervous. And I love the unchurched people because they're going, what? What does that mean? I don't know what that means. Well, you should know that the word here for tongues is the word literally, and you can just do with it what you will. It's just a word for languages. And so a literal interpretation here would be if I speak in the tongues in the languages of men or of angels. And so here's what he says. If I have this supernatural ability to speak every language that's ever been known to man, and this is hyperbole, you can't do that. Nobody has ever been able to speak every language. I have talked to people over the years that could be six or seven languages. I think it's our First Lady, right? Doesn't she speak like seven different languages? And we go, wow, man, that's awesome. Now, most of us as Americans, we only speak English, you know? But if you go to the rest of the world, really the rest of the world is at least bilingual, at least the rest of the world is. So here's what he said. He said, but even if you had the ability to speak every language known to man, and if you could speak in the language of angels, if you could, I know you can't, but if you could, but if you don't have love, and there's that word, love, and you should just know, if you're like new to church, if you've been around church for a while, then you know, right? Oh, there are several Greek words for love. You're right, there are. There's at least three that we know of for sure. There's eros. Hello, we get the word erotic. Somebody just woke up. Said, wow, this is getting good. I'm going to take notes on this one, you know. There's the word eros that we get the word erotic from. There's phileo that we get the word Philadelphia comes from that word. It's brotherly love. And then there's this word agape. And this is unconditional love. That's what he's talking about. It's a verb. It's a verb. It's not an adjective. He's not describing love. He is telling us how love acts. It's a doing word. It's an action-oriented word. It's the kind of love. It's the kind of love where you just don't sit on it. You're not just sitting on a truth, but you actually have to do it. Then he says, I have the gift of prophecy. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom some mysteries, a couple of mysteries. That's not what it says. All mysteries. Dude, if I had the gift of prophecy and I could fathom all mysteries, if I had all knowledge, and again, this is hyperbole. It's an exaggeration. You can't know everything there is to know. Now, I've met some people, and you've met those people who think they're know-it-alls, right? But this is not what Paul's talking about. He said, if you actually had the ability. So he said, even if you're one of those spiritually over-the-top, spiritually gifted Christians who's got all these cool spiritual gifts. If you're one of those people, I mean, like you study, and you're deep, and somebody says John 11, you go, Lazarus. I mean, you're one of those people, you know? And he says, but you know what? If you don't have love, even if, and then he says, if I have faith, if I had the kind of faith that could move mountains. And this, Baptist, we were good till here, weren't we? Because we read that first part and we go, I don't speak in tongues. I'm cool, man. Just move along. And then said, prophecy, and we don't even know what that is in a Baptist church, right? We don't even know what the gift is or if it's real or does it exist or do we know anybody who has the gift? And so, and then we said, I was hurt a little bit when he started talking about know-it-alls. You know, that kind of bothered me a little bit. For the most part, I'm cool. And then he steps up and he says, but if I have the kind of faith, then we go, uh-oh, whoa. Now he's reached out and even got the Baptist crowd in. Because here's the thing that we know. Faith is really important. It's a big topic in the Bible. In fact, Paul, if you believe that he wrote Hebrews, said that without faith it's impossible to please God. So here's what Paul's saying. He said, I'm not saying that it's not important. Of course, faith is important. I'm just saying that without love it's incomplete. And then he gets offensive. Some of you are thinking, it's already been pretty offensive to me. No, now he gets really offensive. He says, if I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, he says, he didn't say it is, he says, I am nothing. He says, you can be the Bible answer man. Good for you. You can be the most ferocious, faith-filled, spiritually gifted leader in the world, but if you don't have love, you're nothing. You know what the word nothing means in the Greek? Nothing. It means you're meaningless. it's no good because you don't do anybody any good. In fact, the only person that you think you're doing any good is you. And most of the time, when you take all of these gifts, as wonderful as these gifts can be, as great as faith can be, that when you take love out, you know what? It just becomes all about you. And he says, I just want to make sure that you understand that you're not impressing God, not a lick. You're not a good follower of Jesus at all. And then he goes like off the chart crazy with hyperbole. Here's what he says. And if I give all I possessed, he didn't say some. This is not somebody who says, I'm going to give my 10%. I'm going to give it 52 weeks out of the year. Hey, you know what? I might even give a Christmas offering and give a bonus. You know, let's take up an offering at Christmas for Jesus. We don't do that anymore. We have done it here. And I said, that's the silliest thing I've ever heard of in my life. Take up an offering for baby Jesus. We're trying to buy a sound system, you know, lights. Why are we saying we're taking this up for Jesus? I can't say that in the next service, but y'all love me, and I know you let me get away with that, right? So let's stop that junk. And he said, listen, but if you give every, this is not tithing. This is off the chart giving it all. And then he says, give my body over to hardship that I may boast. And there's this little Greek thing going on here. Some of your translations may say, if you get home and read your Bible, it may say this. And if I give my body to be burned, wow. And you're thinking, I'm going with your translation. That one's just nasty. But when you put it all together, here's what Paul's saying. He says, let's say that I give everything that I have to the poor. I mean, everything. I mean, I don't have anything. I don't have a dollar left in my pocket. I don't have a quarter. I don't have a penny. I've given everything I have. And then let's say that I am still so generous that I decide that what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to sell myself into slavery. So I'm going to sell myself, and then I sell myself, and when they give me the money for me, then I give all that money away. He said, that would be like ridiculous. Nobody's going to do that. This is hyperbole off the chart. In other words, he's saying, if you're the most generous person in the history of generosity, but if you don't have love, you're nothing. So here's his point. Devotion to God doesn't stop at moral perfection. And that's a joke, like we could obtain moral perfection. So a couple of y'all got that, or a couple of y'all still think, I can see you going, what? Let me think about that. And that's where the devil wants to get us. He wants to get us caught up in moral perfection that we chase moral perfection, something that we will never obtain here on earth. It doesn't end with I have a clear conscience. Paul says, man, pursue holiness? Yes, of course you pursue holiness. Man, that's great, but that's the introduction. I mean, that's just the introduction, and it's not about performance. It's not to perform. It's not to give to impress. It's not to give my life to impress. That's not it. It's that I fall head over heels in love with Jesus because of what Jesus did for me, and the rest of this stuff just oozes out of me. That I'm learning how to love other people the way that he loves me. He says, that stuff is good, but it's just the introduction. And if it goes no further, then you're nothing more than an annoying version of you. Thank you. I thought that was funny too. Me and you are the only ones. I got it. So if you're not a Christian, maybe we owe you an apology. And maybe this is why you don't do church. And this is when you do church, you know what? You do walk in and you're a little bit anxious. You're a little bit nervous. But you're desperate. This is just where a lot of us just got it wrong. Unintentionally got it wrong. We didn't do it on purpose. Maybe it's how we were raised. I don't know. And you've heard me talk about this. And I can't remember specifically that preacher said, but I somehow just walked away thinking that Christianity was all about just being better. That's really what I got. And I've said this and drilled this maybe too much over the last few weeks, but that was what I walked away with. It's just giving up my bad habits. And I was taught to pray every night. Every night when I pray, I ask God for forgive me of my sins. And do we need to ask God? Of course we do. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with the pursuit of holiness. But here's what I'm saying. If that's all you walked away when you heard the story of Jesus, there's so much more to it than that. I'm sorry. We didn't tell you the gospel. We didn't give you the whole story. We messed up. So let me ask you, of these two things, which are you the most grateful for? Two things, which one are you the most grateful for? Number one, God's sinless perfection. So like is your testimony, oh man, what really cranks my tractor is to think that he was sinless. And you probably got a verse of scripture, and if you don't, let me help you out, because you should. Hebrews 4:15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. And then maybe these last five words of which you would cling to, if this would be your testimony, this is what cranks my tractor when it comes to Jesus. Yet, he did not sin. Here's your second choice. God's sacrificial intervention. Theology words, what do they mean? It means this, is that God sent his perfect son into our mess for our good. You could write that down and say, man, my pastor. You don't get that out of a commentary. I probably should. I would have been safer if I'd have got that out of a commentary, wouldn't I? That's God's sacrificial intervention. So when you listen, here's what does it for me. Here's what breaks me every time. And I've been doing this a long time. Been in the ministry over 30 years. Here's what gets still to this day. Y'all know me. It gets me every time. Every time when I think about my sinfulness, when I look in the mirror, when I look at me, and when I realize who I am and what I think, I mean, let's say that, okay, I've done a little better over the years, and I've been able to find some healing in this area, and I've give up that habit. But you know what? Every time I still look in the mirror, I'm still reminded of my sin. I'm still reminded of my junk. And then when I think that God still loves me and that what he did on the cross was he paid for all of my sin for all time, that's what gets me excited and makes me the most grateful. At the epicenter of the gospel is the fact. It's not what God knows, it's what God did. Right? And our devotion to God is incomplete until we put motion with our devotion. Because again, our devotion to God is authenticated to God by the love that we have for him, but also by the love that we have for each other. What if this had been the posture of the church for the last 2,000 years? Hey, this would be crazy. So like, what if the only reason that people resisted Jesus and the church and the church is because we say that we believe in Jesus. Like, what if that was the only thing? They say, oh, I'm going to stop buying that Jesus stuff. Okay. What if the only reason that people resisted the church was because we say we believe in the resurrection? What if that was it? Like, what if those were the only reasons that people don't go to church? I don't believe in Jesus. I'm not buying the resurrection. What if that was it? Because I'm going to tell you what I've learned over the years. I've been doing this a long time. Nobody ever resisted the church because we love too much. Listen, I've been doing this a long time. I hear stuff that other pastors don't hear. We got a staff that can testify to that. I'm just telling you, I've never sat down with anybody yet. So I would believe in Jesus, but that church is just too loving for me. I ain't going. They're too giving. Them people, Lord, if you have a need, they'll help you. Don't go back. If you're struggling, don't go there. They'll want to walk with you. Yeah, it's crazy. You might get a sponsor. Yes. Yeah, those of you who don't know anything about CR, go, what? I just lost you. Nobody ever resisted the church because we carry each other's burdens or because we love too much. What people find easy to resist about Christians is that we don't practice what we preach. You know what? We talk about love. We've studied love. We know all the Greek words about love. We know where you find them. We know their origin. We know the history. We just don't love. What if we studied more so that we can learn more, so that we could love more? What if we changed all that? What if we were more proud of the fact that the closer we get to Jesus, the more that we know about God, the more that our knowledge, the more that we understand theology, the closer to Him that we become, the more that we want to be like Him, and the more that we want to love like He loved, and that we want to bring down walls that separate people groups from the church. And we want to be able to reach out and say, you know what? In Jesus' name, we love you. Do we approve of your sin? Well, shoot, no, but we don't approve of our sin either. You're no more guilty of sin than we are. We're all sinners. That was the point of the cross. What if we started to actually get our theology straight? And we started to love like He loved. Which brings us back to the question, what breaks your heart? What breaks your heart, and are you willing to put some motion in your devotion? And just so you know, you may not have to quit your job, but you're probably going to have to quit something. You know, I thought about this. I thought, man, could we leave that part out? You know, you probably won't have to leave the country, but you're going to have to leave your comfort zone. And honestly, if I'm just going to be just gut level honest with you, you're not going to have to give all your money away, but chances are really good you're going to have to give more than you give. I know I probably should have left that part out. It would have been a sweeter imitation, wouldn't it? But like I said last week, and I've already said it this week, will it be worth it? Yeah. Oh my gosh. We have the most incredible stories. You know why? Because I can look around this room, and I am right now, and I'm seeing people who have just given. And you've served, and you've loved. And the more that you serve, and the more that you give, and the more that you love, you know what? The more that you want to give, and the more that you want to serve, and the more that you want to love. We're the weird church in town. We have to take people aside and say, you're doing too much. Slow down. Back up. Hey, come on now. You can't be here every night of the week. Really, it's okay. Rest a little bit. Is it worth it? Yeah. So what breaks your heart? What keeps you up at night? It is time that we as the church quit talking theology and we started living our theology. It's time for us to rise up and be who God's called us to be.